All right, well, why don't we get things started? Greetings, everyone. Welcome to the Future Trends Forum. My name is Brian Alexander. I'm your host and cat herder for the next hour. Today, we're going to be focusing on inter-campus collaboration and how to do it right. Now, I have a few introductory notes before we get started, so please draw your eyes to the PowerPoint stack to my right. First of all, I just want to make sure you know that this forum is a discussion, and it's an outgrowth of my Future Trends in Technology and Education report. That's a monthly report. A new issue is coming out in a couple of days. It takes a look at recent trends in technology and education, recent as in the past month, and summarizes them in a very, very concise and resource-backed way. It's been going on for about 5 years now, so we have a lot of longitudinal information about which trends are most significant and which ones are flash in the pans. If you haven't seen it before, go to ftte.us. You can download some sample issues or sign up. Now, we should also say a few more words about this forum and how it works. One is that it is an international forum at this point. If you take a look at this map, each green pin represents one nation which has had at least one person sign in. So you can tell that, unfortunately, except for Africa, we are represented around the world, the Middle East, East Asia, Europe, South America, and all of North America. And if you're curious too, those little yellow pins represent different locations where I've been hosting this. So you can see I get around a bit. It's really important to think about education in the future in a global sense. And I'm delighted to see that we're doing that here. Now, we can only do this with the help of some very generous sponsors. So first, I want to thank NYSERNet from New York State, a nonprofit that works to network education. They've been very helpful. We thank them. I also want to thank Shindig because they have given us two very, very generous gifts. One is this technology that we're using right now, and I'll explain a bit about that in a sec. And the second is that they have helped us with so many wonderful people, Olivia, Christopher, Zach. These have all been doing great work in making sure that all the technology works and all the people get together to talk. So we thank them very much for that. And before we go any further, one more thing to add. Yeah, forget the next slide. Which is that we are trying to become sustainable. And by we, I mean all the different Future Trends work that I do, from my blog to this forum to the possible podcast to the Future Trends report. In order to become sustainable, we are seeking sponsorship. You've seen that we've been sponsored by a couple of wonderful firms. We're also looking to you. We're reaching out to people around the world. If you're interested in supporting these kind of conversations, this information, this research, this way of thinking about the future, please go to patreon.com/BrianAlexander. We'd love to hear from you, and any support you can give would be greatly appreciated. Like they say in public radio, we can't do this without you. Now, when I say this, I need to introduce you to two things. One is the technology, and one is our next guest. So, if you're new to Shindig, or if you haven't been here for a while, let me point out that the very top of the screen where I am and where this PowerPoint slide is called the stage. That's where presenters are. And during the show, if you'd like, you can come up on stage and join us. If your mic and your camera are working, you can have two, three people up here in addition to myself and the guest. Now below us is the entire audience, all of you, the participants. And once about 20 of them appear, we open another virtual room and another virtual room beyond that. So far, hundreds of people can fit in this giant participant swarm. And you can see different people. Some of them right now, like Liz or Sandra, you can see a video feed of them smiling, perhaps looking embarrassed because I called them out. Other people are represented by a silhouette, like Michael and Linda. Each one of those represents a person or a sign-in for a larger room. Chris Boylan, for example, right now. Hello, Chris, is in the middle of a room, a conference room. So if you would like, at any point during this hour, if you'd like to chat with somebody, you can simply click on them, and your two cursors will move together, and you'll have a special private spot where you can talk to each other. Now, also on the screen, you can see on the far right are a couple of logos. So those have, if you click on the FTTE button or the picture of me with coffee, you can learn more about either of us. Now, if you look at the bottom right, there's a little teal panel with three buttons, and this is really important because this shows ways that you can connect with people and interact with them. So first, there's a little question mark. If you click that, then you can type in a question, and we can read that out loud and we can flash it on the screen. So that's a very, very useful way to connect. If your camera is working, your mic is working, and you'd like to talk with us in video, click the next button, that raise hand. That'll tell us you'd like to join us on stage. So when the time is right, we'll bring you up on stage and you can have at it. Now, to the right of that is a chat box. It says, I am. And if you click that, you can chat with everybody in the room around you. So right now, I've been seeing Sandra, Kathy, Jeremy, Chris, Olivia, Linda, all chatting and saying hi. So please use that to say hello and to talk with people. If that's not enough, you can head on over to Twitter and just use the hashtag FTTE for Future Trends in Technology and Education. And you'll see already that people have been tweeting with comments and questions, some that are in here right now and some that are elsewhere in the world. So we have a lot of ways to talk. And again, this is about discussion. I'll stop yapping in just a second. But first, I need to introduce our guest. So I'm very, very pleased to have Liz Evans, because Liz is a friend that I've known for many years. And Liz, as you'll see, is doing some fantastic work. She's based in Philadelphia, part of the Rebel Blue City Alliance, I think. And she is the director of LACOL, the Liberal Arts Consortium for Online Learning. What that is, what she does with it, and why this matters to everybody in education, that's what we're going to be talking about. So Zach, if you could bring Liz up on stage, we can get started. Hello, Liz.
Hi, Brian. How are you?
Excellent. It's great to see you.
Good to see you.
So again, if you're new to the Shindig environment, so you will see that here's Liz. So she and I can be having this conversation. Anybody who'd like to join us up on stage, please just click the raise hand button, and we have plenty of room for you. So Liz, let me just begin by asking first, what is LACOL, this Liberal Arts Consortium?
Well, I'm glad you asked. The Liberal Arts Consortium for Online Learning, often called LACOL, sometimes called LACOL, sometimes called LACOL. We accept all pronunciations. It is a partnership of 9 liberal arts institutions that are exploring various aspects of online and blended learning together. We are Amherst College, Bryn Mawr College, Carleton College, Haverford College, Pomona College, Swarthmore College, Vassar College, Washington and Lee University, and Williams College. I'll give just a really brief version of the history of LACOL. It was founded in 2014, and as you may recall, and it's only 3 years ago, but back then there was a lot of discussion happening about online learning in general, the so-called year of the MOOC, lots of consideration within across all of higher ed, but within liberal arts. How does online and blended learning fit in with the residential liberal arts model and so forth? And so that conversation went in a variety of ways. And actually, several weeks ago, you had Kristen Eshelman here on this forum. She talked about one outcome of that was some of the experiments that liberal arts colleges have done in MOOCs and the edX platform and things that group, Davidson, Hamilton, Colgate, Wellesley, Smith, Trinity, they've been experimenting on the edX platform. The schools that got together and eventually became LACOL were interested in that to some extent, but not necessarily specifically in MOOCs. But at the same time, I think they really recognized an opportunity to work together on these issues, recognizing both that there was a lot of individual experimentation happening with our faculty and IT groups and within our libraries, but really a lot of ways that we could be working together, not only just to share knowledge and information, that happens in lots of different ways, but for the consortium really exists to provide a framework for experimentation and a kind of project management platform for that. So just as a brief way of history, when things got started in 2014, that was due to the really great work of the founding co-directors. That was Brian Penpraise, a professor of astronomy at Pomona College, also working with Andrea Nixon, director of educational research at Carleton College. And Brian and Andrea really got everything with the consortium off the ground. And one of the main ways they did that was to hold a consortium-wide workshop at Pomona College in June of 2014. All our member campuses sent teams of faculty, librarians, technologists, academic support people, all the kinds of people that work and think about these issues. For a face-to-face event, a lot of talking about not only what was happening within online learning, but specifically what are the opportunities for collaboration? Where could working together on these issues get us further than just the individual work happening on each campus? So at that Pomona workshop, actually an outgrowth of that was establishing the four working groups of the consortium that we still are roughly organized around today. And those four are a group on active and engaged reading, looking at aspects of academic reading in a digital age, the effective teaching and learning working group, interested in emerging online and blended pedagogies for the liberal arts. The third group is language instruction, looking specifically for opportunities where online and blended tools can enhance language instruction. And then the fourth group is quantitative skills, looking at ways to support students with their quantitative work across the curriculum. And from those working groups, we've developed a series of projects and initiatives that we're working on, and maybe we'll get into those a little bit more later. But just to kind of wrap up the history and where I fit in, from that time back in 2014, actually, both Andrea and Brian have gone off to do other amazing things. Brian's working now with Yale NUS, and Andrea's her work at Carleton, as well as all kinds of amazing things she's doing with the NSF. On their departure, actually, the consortium took an opportunity to reorganize just a little bit to create my role as a full-time director role, with that recognition that in order for some of these efforts and projects to really really be sustainable, there needed to be that coordination and kind of project management role. And so day-to-day, that's really what I work on.
When you say project management, are these four groups engaged in each of them creating different projects, or do you consider each of them to be a project?
Yeah, they are engaged in projects. Each group has a life of its own, and you know, certain of them have had just some online talks and events and guest speakers and so forth. So they get together from time to time just to talk about their common areas of interest. But meanwhile, to varying degrees, each group is engaged in defining, kicking off, and or is in the midst of project work. And so within the scope of each project, there might be somebody really playing the lead role in managing that project. And I'm usually in more of a little of an overarching role, just trying to make sure that everything, all the dots stay connected.
I see. I have so many questions about this. And let me just say, first of all, if you have a question at this point, like, how does this work? How does it work when they're non-co-located? What is the liberal arts aspect of this? Is there anything that you can do from your campus to learn from it or connect? Please, again, either just click the raised hand button to come on stage, click the question mark to type in a question, or hit Twitter and fling a question at us right now. So the first question I would ask to follow up on that great presentation is, how is all this sustainable? Who pays the bills for all this work?
Yeah. Well, the consortium was really funded by the group of schools coming together and for the most part self-funded in terms of contributions, both just to kind of keep the lights on, but also for the project work. And there's both a general pool of funds available for some kickstarting of projects, and then to some extent projects based on participation. If certain schools want to get together and do something, we have a mechanism basically where they kind of agree to share the costs. By no means does that preclude the efforts that to obtain some external funding, and as we're seeing a couple of our projects start to mature to that point, that's certainly something we'll also want to do as well.
Do you think the campuses contribute both in funding, but also in kind, by contributing, say, time in these projects, the time of faculty, or support staff help?
Yeah, that's definitely the case. And, you know, the issue of time, that's the scarcest resource of all, as we all know, is the way that we work. Everyone's very busy on their own campuses with all of the things on their plate already. And so carving out the time to work on collaborative projects is really a key question and how to do that. We have a fantastic group of faculty, staff, and in some cases, students involved in projects as well. And I think there's a lot of enthusiasm. It's just really literally, how can people find the time to do it?
Yes.
Sometimes that is a funding question, and if there are, mechanisms to provide funding for supplemental staff or stipend, things along those lines, some of the effort is indeed donated, and especially where we can connect the projects that we're doing to initiatives that are already happening on campus, it's a pretty good opportunity for that kind of synergy.
Well, it makes a lot of sense. Let me ask. You said that this big idea of getting people to explore digital learning, what keeps people going? Incentive to have them participate?
Yeah, I think it's, we're always looking for those opportunities where collaboration is going to add something, add extra benefit, and really allow us to ask different questions, ask better questions, make progress more quickly on the issues that people are working on and care about. We're both focused on some of the topics that we've identified where there is that energy. People are already working on this individually. They see benefits of pooling resources, sharing knowledge, or contributing labor into a joint sort of a joint larger project. At the same time, we're also we try and keep the door open to new ideas and keep the conversation going about the changing landscape in teaching with technology, emerging pedagogies, practices, and so forth. With a little bit of throw spaghetti against the wall approach in the sense of just seeing what sticks, because I think there are things where people have the thought and the idea that collaborating may be interesting in a certain area, but you might never know until you just sort of give it a try and see if it's going to be
Sure.
sustainable or not.
So you've got a project wing and you also have an information sharing wing. And the two are together, but these are two different functions.
Yep, absolutely.
How do you, I'm curious, how do you connect and build communications between these campuses? I mean, some of them are relatively close geographically, but some are on opposite ends of the country.
Yeah, it really it takes numerous things, hopefully all sort of working in coordination, but you're exactly right. We're a national consortium from California to Massachusetts down to Virginia. So on the one hand, we do try and get together in person, face to face, as much as is feasible. From the Pomona Conference, we've tried to roughly annually have a consortium-wide workshop, and our last one was last June in at Haver here at Haverford College, where I'm based. Our next one is coming up at Vassar College in June. So certainly those moments when people can come together are key in building those relationships and strengthening the network. But even so, I think that we're in exactly the challenge that you're pointing to, that on each of our campuses, we value our local champions, and we're structured around both an administrative advisory council and a faculty advisory council. The members on our faculty advisory council are fantastic, and they are really the anchor that connects us into the community, as well as our CIOs, our IT directors, instructional technologists, librarians. So people that are directly involved with the working groups and involved with the projects are probably the best way that we have to connect further into the campus life and campus culture. Just even to have the awareness, it's not necessarily the case that faculty on all our campuses know about the consortium or are aware of the opportunities. If they have an idea that might benefit from collaboration, are they even aware, or do they know how to get connected in? So I think that the relationships are on campus are the key, and of course we have our website, we have newsletters, we have some of the other kind of communications channels, Twitter and so forth, all trying to work in harmony along those lines.
What do you think works best so far for you right now beyond face to face?
Well, I think it is trying to get what's happening with the consortium into the local conversations and the local channels. I think that's when it happens, that's the best thing. I think, you know, the other thing for us is just we've been trying to sort of boot up and get energy behind these various projects, and we haven't, you know, gone in specifically for each of the working groups, but certainly the quantitative skills group just had a great workshop in this past January. They're looking at the practices for curating and implementing online resources to support students. So as we're having projects sort of get into the implementation phase and start yielding some results, I think that's one of the other things that's really going to help us with that communication, because I think people have a question mark, you know, what is the purpose of the consortium? We can say that in words, but until they kind of see the actions of what the projects are really leading to, that's when they really start to, I think, see the value that the collaboration piece is bringing.
I was really impressed by the quantitative project. I think that's a multi-campus math unit. Am I right? Can you say more about how this works?
A couple things that are quantitatively related, and the one you may be referring to is there's a course sharing experiment that's underway right now, and that is a multi-campus initiative involving advanced mathematics courses. The idea behind that is that all of our member campuses, of course, offer advanced mathematics courses locally, but being relatively small as liberal arts institutions, not every campus can offer every advanced class every year that they might like to. The idea of course sharing, very attractive, and the tools and techniques becoming better and better for that. So we do have that collaboration underway right now with six of our member campuses involved. The two primarily active in terms of offering these course experiences at the moment. We're doing kind of a proof of concept phase right now where Professor Stephen Miller at Williams College is opening up parts of his problem solving course this spring, making that available to some remote students at a couple of the other campuses. That will lead into what's planned for next year as a pilot course coming out of Pomona College, and again with the idea that students from across all of our campuses would have the opportunity to take that course. So it's really been an interesting project for us so far. Of course, it brings up all sorts of questions of not only the technology, but what are the appropriate pedagogies for that kind of instruction? Given that mathematics can run to all sorts of, it has a lecture mode, seminar style, problem solving. A lot of different modalities that you would want to be able to offer as something for students in that way. And I think for us, it's also raising interesting kind of policy and process questions along the way, partly just back to the question of collaborating. How can we actually manage this project across space and time, involving multiple faculty, multiple IT groups? How do we stay on the same page and manage that? And then, an important question as a consortium interested in online learning for the liberal arts are the kind of credit-related questions. This project has brought up a great opportunity for those conversations to be happening in various ways on our campuses, both the credit for faculty teaching question, if faculty are going to be engaged in this kind of teaching across a network. We have, within our consortium, lots of our members are already in other consortia that do course sharing, so that's not brand new, but bringing in the online piece has raised that question for faculty credit and as well for student credit.
It's a classic problem, I should just say. Just for a little background, I worked with the National Institute for Technology and Liberal Education, which was supporting some similar such programs, and in fact played a key role in the growth of Synoikisis, which is a shared class, shared resource project for classical studies. In 1999, 2001, I team taught a class involving three different campuses about the Vietnam War. More recently, the Council of Independent Colleges has been doing some upper-level humanities seminars across multiple campuses. So there seems to be a pattern here of small colleges that are like colleges that have a shared interest in a specialty. So it's not, when you say advanced math, you don't mean, say, intro calculus or remedial trig. I mean, you're talking about advanced number theory, something else. So these campuses can really expand their offerings. They can have access to a greater curriculum.
Yeah, I think that's right. And the Synoikisis project is a great one that I've really been trying to learn from and see what they're doing. And I think, you know, several other consortia have similar kinds of projects, and ACM has more something along the calculus lines. I think the niche where this has come up as an opportunity for us just happens to be in recognition of the curricular needs within advanced mathematics and statistics as well. And, you know, I think we're always needing to reflect the diversity of our campuses, find where there's some alignment for those kind of interests. Not every campus feels necessarily the same way about it, but there's enough of an opportunity there for us to build an interesting project around it.
Yes, and it can really be a question of scale. So you may have one student at Pomona, say, who is really keen on and ready for advanced irrational numbers, but they're only one student. So this could be something which they might not pursue as a result, or they could only do as a independent study. But here they could team up with 6-12 other students and have a nice seminar experience. We have a question coming up from, let's see, this is from Greg at UNC Asheville. So let me try and bring this up. Well, while we're working on that, let me just remind everybody else that there are a lot of questions that you should probably feel free to ask Greg about now. Greg asks, LACOL membership with NC SARA. I'm not sure what NC SARA is. I think that's North Carolina SARA. How does LACOL coordinate NC SARA policies and procedures, given that there is no one central host state?
Not quite sure.
Well, Greg, if you want to unfold that question, please send us more. But this is a you are doing an interstate project. So how can you, how are you able to get around that? I mean, are there any issues of crossing state boundaries?
Yeah. I don't think we're quite to the point of needing to answer those kinds of questions. Really, the explorations are raising those kind of conversations on our campuses, and we're not, I think a lot of, either, you know, college or university systems that are offering states or offering courses that are going to cross state boundaries are going to need to answer that question. We don't have that kind of formal policy in place at the moment. So probably I would need to turn that question around and say what we'll be doing is looking to learn from those who are already, answering those kind of questions.
Well, one thing I guess maybe I should have mentioned this earlier is that these are all private colleges. So they don't have, their relationship to state policy is a little different than that of, say, public universities, public colleges.
True.
Oh, this is a good question. There are all kinds of really interesting and thorny questions about getting these to work. Let me ask another question, which is, when you're trying to get all these faculty to work with each other, and you're also trying to get their support staff together, How do you govern this? I mean, I know you're the director, but you have to report to someone. And you mentioned there's a faculty advisory council. Are there more bodies than this? Is there more structure than that?
The two structured groups that we have are our administrative advisory council, which is our presidents and chief academic officers. That group meets on a fairly regular basis and sets our overall direction and also evaluates the project proposals that we have coming through our pipeline. And then our second formal group is our faculty advisory council. We have two faculty members from each of our member institutions that are on that council. They meet approximately monthly, and again, you know, guiding the overall direction of the consortium and shaping our goals and how to implement, and then also doing the project evaluation piece as well. So from there, then, as our projects have developed and defined more on an individual project basis, it's putting together project teams and typically looking to have, depending on the nature of the work, a faculty lead, a technical lead, and if it's involving aspects of digital scholarship, perhaps somebody from the libraries. And you know, it has the challenges that you might expect in trying to coordinate a project across space and time, clarifying the roles and responsibilities, the relationship. And I think for the most part, being able to divide up the work in a way that can be distributed in a fairly clear way, where people can have a good idea of what's being asked of them, what are the ways that they could contribute in small incremental chunks that they could fit into the rest of the work that they're doing, and you know, also for reaping the benefits, what might any individual project have as quote unquote deliverables to offer any of our member campuses, and how would they make use of them? So as we're sort of progressing in what different projects are coming up with, we're going to be having to answer these very questions that I think these collaborative projects inevitably do about the project management, but also about intellectual property and repositories for shared assets and managing the metadata and all of those kind of things. I think we're fortunate in being able to learn from a lot of efforts along these lines, and Knightley is a great example of really an organization that broke tremendous ground, and I think a lot of the other consortiums working along these lines as well. But each project is a little bit of its own puzzle to solve along those lines, and you have to kind of work with the people involved and try and tap into the working styles of the faculty and what their relationships are, as well as I think something that we rely on tremendously is the pre-existing relationships that faculty have with their IT and library counterparts already, and a lot of connections already across our whole sector, fostered by all these kind of communities as well.
Fascinating. I mean, you've anticipated my next question, and this is a question which we're going to lead into a mingle for, which is how do you practically do all this work, given its complexity and also spatial distribution? And you've mentioned the importance of face-to-face events, and I've heard this from just about every distributed project, that the face-to-face meetings are still really cherished. You've mentioned connecting through individual people and teams. You mentioned that you have a site, you have a newsletter, you social media. And then now you just added that you you also very wisely tap into people's working styles, which is very important to hear what they're doing and respond rather than forcing something on them. And that you also rely on local and distributed pre-existing collaborations. Now, that's a pretty sophisticated toolkit. Let me ask, there's also a body of experience coming out of the working from home movement. Have you learned anything from that? I mean, is there anything that you've learned about what it's like to work when people are home in their pajamas or versus being in the office?
Well, I certainly would say, based on my own personal experience, I've spent time working at different higher ed institutions, small liberal arts colleges, large universities, but I've also done some work in the cloud software industry. And in fact, myself was working at home and learned quite a lot about leading projects in pajamas and slippers, and all of the things that come with that. And, one of the things that's really been interesting for me coming into my role now with the consortium, and I've been in this role for about a year and a half, some of the similarities and differences in the culture around remote collaboration, comparing business to higher ed, and some of the things that are just assumed and normal business sort of corporate collaborative modes are less familiar in the higher ed culture. And I've even found this across the different working groups, that some of the working groups take to having something like this forum, a remote forum where people are doing work right within this kind of setting, and it definitely very much helps to have established a face-to-face in-person relationship and bring that into the online realm. Some teams seem to have made that transition fairly easily. The biggest problem synchronously is simply finding time. It's a huge scheduling yeah. challenge yeah. just to find the time of day when people can all meet. Try and supplement that with providing options to have asynchronous channels going on, whether that's, actually for the most part it ends up being email, even if we try and use other kinds of forums or a Slack chat or something like that. Email seems to always eventually win the day. It's a combination of having the familiarity and the sense of the team as a remote team, and being able to work in that style. And I think the other aspect of it is simply prioritization, that for a lot of people, they're very interested, they've got the spark of enthusiasm, whatever the project may be, they're more than willing to give the time, but because their day job is right in front of them and tends to be the thing that's screaming the loudest, it's kind of constantly needing to go back and bring the more distributed online work back to the center and have a little bit of attention paid to it.
Is that part of your role to kind of nudge people back on course?
I mean, I think overall I do a lot of checking in and the herding cat's role a little bit. And that's certainly the case just to keep things on the radar. And it's also, it's striking that balance. Because we're 9 different institutions, we have 9 different academic calendars, some fairly aligned, some quite different. I'm seeing that the project work of the consortium needs to accommodate that, and actually the peak times of academic activity when classes are in full swing are the least active time for the projects, whereas it's grabbing those pockets of time that you can early in the semester, around the breaks in the January term, or certainly the summer, the times when people have a little bit more flexibility and can really set aside time to work on things.
Well, that last point is really, really important. Let me take all of your excellent answers that are hard won through experience. Let me turn them over to the audience. This is the phase in the Future Trends Forum where we mingle. That is, Liz and I climb off the stage down into the crowd amongst you, and we all take turns discussing this question. How can we make non-collated collaboration work? How can we, across campuses, institutions, state lines, even nations, how can we work productively together? What are some of the things that you've learned? So let's share that. What are some of the best practices that you've learned? I mean, is it the scheduling during the year, as Liz mentioned, trying to get people during the relatively slack times? Is it a question of a specific technology that just wins the day for you? How do you do this non-collocated working? Let's take 5 minutes and talk about that. Now, if you haven't done this before, the way we talk is you find somebody else in your room that looks interesting, and you click on them. And if they want to talk to you, your two icons will come together and you'll have your own kind of cone of silence, your own audiovisual chat bubble. If you don't feel like talking to somebody because, say, your mic doesn't work or you're in a crowded public space, you just get to refuse the connection, so they don't have to bug you unless you want them to. So let's take 5 minutes. Talk to each other, if you're ready to talk, about how you best collaborate across physical boundaries. We'll come back in about 5 minutes. Okay, let's go. this is exciting. One of the things I love about the forum, and there are so many things I love about this, but it's the chance to get off of presenter mode, get away from that, and to talk to people on a one-to-one or small group basis. And I love that the technology can facilitate that, and I'm so happy with the variety of people who have so many different ideas or questions that I would not have asked or would have thought of. So I hope you find this too. Liz, you're back.
Hello.
We've got a great question from Gary. Let's see if we can bring him up. He is in a great position where he's starting a new role, and he might be able to launch one of these. So he should be coming up now. This gets very dramatic.
The suspense.
Well, it's but while we're bringing him up, let me ask: what did you find in your mingling session? What did you learn? What came up?
Yeah. Well, I had a chance to talk with Sandra, and we were having a couple of little audio issues. So I hope I got her situation correctly. But she was at a business school, I believe, at USC. Mm-hmm. Might have the school wrong, but talking a little bit about the difference for the undergraduate experience and the way that online learning may fit as an option for undergraduates compared to in the business and professional school setting, where as students are moving into their career, balancing work and school a little bit differently, the online options become even more attractive. And yeah, perhaps the case is a little easier to make there. I think in the undergraduate realm, it's a little bit, and certainly in the residential setting, it's a little bit still under discovery, quite how the online options are going to fit in. So yeah, it was great to talk with Sandra.
Oh, that's a good point. That's a very, very important distinction, and I suspect, given demographics, one that we'll see more of. Yeah. Liz, let me introduce you to Gary Bartenes. Gary is just starting a new position, and he's curious about how do you start something like LACOL from the ground up? What are the first couple of steps to get people to buy in? Well, actually, Gary, why don't you ask, since I'm just ventriloquizing here.
Well, it's a very, very exciting thing. And as Brian says, I'll be starting a new role in March. And I'm not sure where the university is in regards to any consortium activities. And I'm, you know, hoping they are involved. But if they are not, I would love to know more about your experience as to how it all began. If I missed it in your earlier presentation, please forgive me. I'm kind of new at this. But if you could expand more on that, talk about that, and perhaps also maybe talk about some of the resistance that you might get from other partners or institutions that you think should become partners of your consortium, and why would they resist such an opportunity? Because apparently there are some that you know, even consortiums themselves, they will say, "That's it, we're going to stop at this point, and we're not going to bring any other partners in." So, if you could maybe talk a bit about that, I'd sure appreciate that.
Yeah, those are great, great questions. And I wasn't part of the original founding of the consortium, but I think I can share what I've learned about that. And certainly from the time that I've been here, I think, you know, some similar issues. I think that the energy of the consortium did really tap into the conversations that were happening around 2013, 2014, perhaps a little bit of a sense of urgency about this question of online learning and MOOCs that was in the air at the time. I think that was something that that the schools were all thinking about individually themselves, and having the recognition in various venues that that they had a lot in common on these issues. So I think the key ingredient for any successful collaboration or consortium is identifying those common needs, those common areas of interest, because I think we all know that there is an overhead to collaborating, and it doesn't always come easily. You have to have a good reason to put the energy into making it work and making it be successful. And that actually connects very well into the second part of your question of I don't know if I would use resistance, just the genuine, you know, questioning the value. What is the value of putting energy and putting time and money into this collaboration? Will this actually lead to progress above and beyond what we might be able to do individually and making that case? I think for us, that for the Liberal Arts Consortium for Online Learning, that's been a particularly interesting question, because for small residential liberal arts institutions, the question of the role of online and blended learning itself is one. There are many, many different viewpoints, and that's part of the richness that we draw on as we even think about what we might want to work on together and do together. But I don't think there's universal agreement about what online and blended learning should be, what their role should be in our institutions. But for us, that's part of the point. That's part of the experimentation and the discovery that we're even doing, is to ask that question and just be trying some different things and gathering experience and gathering data. So I would say, you know, the thing that has made us be able to have the journey and go as far as we've gone so far is, it's a combination of trying to tap into the existing energy, and in the case of some of these, you know, exploring emerging pedagogies, that is what our faculty are interested in, what they are already trying, the ways that they are seeing that collaboration opens up new questions, new relationships, you know, could potentially divide labor in ways that would make us more efficient and more effective. So I think we're looking for that kind of bottom-up energy, but it is also important to connect it to the kind of, I wouldn't say top down, but to the institutional goals, and have the work that we're doing really align with the institutional priorities of all of our members. And again, it doesn't mean that all 9 members are always interested in the same thing at the same time, but right. In combinations, trying to figure out what kind of work would actually bring back benefits to the campuses that they're going to value and they're going to see as worthwhile. So I hope that answered your question.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Thank you very much. The perspective is much more positive than perhaps what I was coming from. So that really helps a lot. Thank you.
Great.
Well, please follow up, Gary, as your career progresses. We'd love to hear more.
Yeah. Thank you. I will.
Good luck to you.
Thank you.
And we have time for one or two other questions from folks. So again, if you'd like to come up on stage like Gary just did, and my God, Gary has got the most fantastic voice. This is a man who should be audiobook central. Or if you don't have a question, if you don't have the will or the capacity to talk out loud, no problem. Just please type in a question and we'd love to hear from you. I have a question at the association level. So if Shelley Alcorn were here, I'm sure she'd be all over this. Are there any other consortia or organizations that you get to work with that help LACOL? For example, do you work with, say, the American Association of Colleges and Universities, which is a dean and provost level group? Do you, since most of your schools are in the Northeast, do you work with NESCAC? Which is an athletic conference, but people often build academics on that. Does EDUCAUSE come in handy and so forth? Or do you do this purely by yourself?
We do work, in informal partnerships. I've certainly gotten a lot of benefit from the Association of Collaborative Leadership as a way to understand the lay of the land and what other consortia are doing. Some of them working in similar areas and kind of academic programming, some of them more on the administrative side. But that's been really, really helpful, just thinking about the ways that educational institutions collaborate on all kinds of levels. EDUCAUSE and ELI have been really instrumental. EduPlace has been really instrumental, and actually, if I can give a shout out, I'll note that several of us from LACOL will be giving a presentation at the ELI annual conference in Houston on Valentine's Day, February 14th at 3:15 in the afternoon. It's a discussion circle about online learning for the liberal arts and collaboration for the liberal arts, so kind of picking up on some of the things we've been talking about today. So if anyone's going to be in Houston at ELI, please stop by. We'd love to see you and keep the conversation going. But back to your question, Brian, I would say, you know, we're focusing on our inter-campus collaborations. And so in some senses, those are, you know, building the relationships between between our individual team components on the different campuses. But we are really fortunate to be able to tap into the kinds of projects that we see happening with AACNU and other organizations as well, because I think as we've been saying, I mean, tracing back from Knightley and on through forward, there are so many ways that these questions have been asked, and people have experimented in various ways. They've seen what works and doesn't work, and there's a lot that we've been learning from that.
Well, I'm really glad to hear it. We may be in a kind of, thanks to technology, we may be in a kind of golden age of collaboration, and we have a lot to learn. One last question. This is the future of technology education that we look at. Where do you see this going in the next, say, 5 years? Do you think you will spawn more work groups? Do you think your groups will have more projects? Do you think other colleges might join you? Do you think you could mutate into something completely different? Where do you see this going?
Yeah, that's a really good question. I think that we've been in a phase of trying to spin up these projects, see how they run, see the strengths and weaknesses of different things that we can do. And I think especially for ones where we might be the other quantitative skills project that we didn't really talk about that's focused on looking at some online bridge and refresher strategies. For things where a project may end up building up a bank of resources, then that sort of sustainability question becomes something huge to think about. How does this work live on after the project itself goes away, and who would own it? So I think there could be several ways where this work could spin off and connect with other kinds of organizations that have that bigger scope and scale. I think that the consortium was started as an experimental approach to spark some kinds of activities, and right now that's the phase that we're in, is really just trying to spark that work. I could see the consortium itself growing and expanding, but I think also, as Gary was alluding to, I mean, even the opportunity to partner with other kinds of institutions and partnerships. I think something we haven't really talked about today is the connection with the mode of using online and blended learning in residential settings compared to other kinds of institutions, and actually broadening and expanding the role of the liberal arts in various ways. So I don't think that necessarily means that the consortium gets bigger, but I think it would be interesting to be working with those other kinds of organizations with those bigger ambitions.
Well, that makes a lot of sense. And I appreciate, because you're the official voice of LACOL, I appreciate the circumspect nature of your speculation. But I think one thing that you left out is that the rest of us will be watching and maybe partnering, but definitely learning from what you discover, what you learn, and what you guys make. What's the best way to keep up with LACOL? We have the Twitter feed of The LACOL, right? Is that the best way, or should we go to the website or what?
Yeah, The LACOL, definitely day to day. We always try and not only post what we're working on, but people that we're working with and interested in and retweeting and so forth. So yeah, I would love to for people to follow us along on Twitter, and definitely the website lacol.net is the best place to go if you're interested in more details about any of the working groups, the specific projects that they're working on, the people that are involved from our member campuses. And on the website, you can also sign up for our quarterly newsletter, which is yet another way to just get a regular update from us, everything that's going on.
Well, it's really handy too. It's a very content rich, and not spamish newsletter at all. It's very, very handy. Well, I'm afraid to say, are out of time. We've reached the end of our hour. You've been enormously generous with your time and your hard-won knowledge. It's been great to learn more about LACOL and what this means for collaboration. I think we'll be seeing a lot more of it. Thank you for being here.
Oh, thanks, Brian. Really enjoyed it.
Well, and thank you to Gary and our UNC Asheville contributor for asking a couple of really, really good questions. Now, because we're out of time, I have to point you to next week. So next week, which is February 2017, we have another spectacular guest. This is Lee Rainey. If you don't know Lee, he's the Director of Internet Science and Technology Research for Pew. If you don't know that work, my God, start following it. That is some of the best social science done about how humans actually use technology. For more than a decade, Pew has been pumping out research notes, papers, visualizations. It is rock solid, incredibly useful stuff about how people use social media, mobile devices, you name it. Lee is a firebrand. He's published at least one book on this. I'm really looking forward to our conversation. Also coming up next week, we have a continuation of our book club. We will be moving into chapters 4 and 5 of Paying the Price. We've already blogged about the previous chapters. We've got some good discussion going on. And again, if you haven't seen this, this is a book about how financial aid is decreasingly useful for helping Americans actually pay for college. It's a very detail-rich book based on cutting-edge, excellent research. We should hopefully have Professor Goldrick-Rabb as a guest on later in a couple of months, but I strongly recommend keeping an eye on this book, reading it for what it means for higher education, and click on the tinyurl.com/Goldrick-Rabb to find out more from my blog. In the meantime, if you'd like to learn more about this Future Transform, or if you'd like to learn about the Future Trends in Technology Education Report, go to ftde.us. If you want to learn more about Shindig, well, shindig.com will take you there. In the meantime, if you're in the northern part of the world, stay warm. I'll stick around for a couple minutes to chat, and I'll see you next week. Take care, and thank you.